a battle against a microphone right now. There we go. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
It fell again. Good morning. Oh. Good morning. There we go. You know, we come to this place as we are, don't we? Reading from Galatians chapter 5. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. Do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh, rather to serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Would you join me in a spirit of unity, of love, of one another, in singing hymn number 108, Come Christians, Join to Sing. You can find it in your hymnal, number 108, or on the screen, see either side of me. Would you remain standing with me as we read together our words of witness? We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, goodness, and love,
and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, who for us and our salvation lived and died and rose again and lives evermore. And in the Holy Spirit, who takes the things of Christ and reveals them to us, renewing, comforting, and inspiring our souls. We are united in striving to know the will of God as taught in the Holy Scriptures, and in our purpose to walk in the ways of the Lord, made known or to be made known to us. Amen.
Thank you. Would you say good morning to someone as you return to your seats?
Good morning.
Good morning. I want to remind you that this afternoon at 4 o'clock right here, Spinet will sponsor a wonderful program that Ed Yarnell has put together. And I would love to see a big showing from our church because you're going to enjoy this program. Ed is the Spinet president this year, and we have quite a few members in our choir. There's Eric and Carol and Chalmer and Sue's out here and Bruce, who are members of Spinet, and we work hard to bring good music to Redlands, and we are very fortunate to have this lovely sanctuary to share with them. So I'd like to see a lot of the congregationalists there this afternoon at 4. You know, it was originally scheduled Tuesday night, and I understand that even though we tried to get all the corrections out, we had a couple people show up. So it's going to be two singers. You know them both, Greg Siples, who has been singing in our choir and plays the trumpet too, and Stephanie Shepson. So they're doing Broadway songs. So it's a lovely day. Come and help support what Ed is trying to do for us. Thank you.
Good morning. Two more announcements for you. This is the last reminder I'll give for the community Bible study because you might be getting tired of hearing it every week. But the registration is still open in case you want to register online for either the in-person class, which is Thursdays at 9:30 to 11:30, or you can go online at the 7 to 8:30 class, and you can do that from the comfort of your home or wherever it may be. If you have any questions about it, you can feel free to ask, or if you need help with registration, I am more than happy to help with that. I do know that this past week was the first class, so you're not, if you want to jump in, if you're on the fence, now is a great time to participate. You've had the opportunity on Sundays to get to know Kelly a little bit, and she's been out in our courtyard area talking to getting to know you as well. But one of the things I really love about this Bible study that I get to see each week is the companionship of people and the connection. And so if you're longing for that sense of connection and you're available during those times, this is a great way to be connected with other people in our community. And then the other reminder is next Sunday we have our Dealing with Dying, and that's with Reverend Craig Walker. And he is currently in Flagstaff, but he will be here for that. If you're unable to attend, again, it's at 11 a.m. here in the sanctuary. We have it online on YouTube, both on our website and on our YouTube channel as well. So if you can't make it in person, this is a particularly important topic. They all are, but I know personally sometimes it's really challenging to understand what are the words that I need to have or the presence that I need to carry into a space when I'm comforting somebody that's going through grief. And this is really a helpful topic that I think will serve all of us, including those that will journey through grief. The final reminder is the kids, you can go to your classrooms after our special music. And then as we transition in our time of worship into consideration of our offering and giving, we have the baskets in the back to keep one another healthy and safe. We also have donations online or in person. You can come into the office during our office hours. Thank you.
I am, Lord, take and use me, for I know you have a plan for me. Here I am, Lord, take and use me, for I know night is lonely, I have no light to see. Still I hear your voice, Lord, calling to me. Here I am. plan for me. Here I am, Lord, take and use me, for I know you care for me. When the dawn is breaking, I face a day unknown. Yet your light reveals, Lord, I'm not alone. Here I am, Lord, take and use me, for I know you have a plan for me. And use me, for I know you care for me. For I know you care for me.
I think the posture of "Here I am, Lord" is a perfect segue into the posture of prayer. This morning, if you'll permit me, I'd like to flip the order just a little bit and have the minute of quietness before we have our congregational prayer today. I would love for you to consider for a moment what you carried into this space today. What are the things that are in your mind and your heart? What are the things that you can't help but pray about? But then that "Here I am" posture, as though Jesus is sitting across from you with tender eyes ready to listen, an attentive heart for you. So would you take a minute with me in just quietness and prayer before God? Gracious and loving God, where can we find you? Where are you as we hold questions, doubts, failures, shame, and sorrows? When we feel alone and helpless, wandering and lost, you are with us. Where are you in our joy, celebration, transformation, and renewal, where we can't imagine a better life to live? You are with us. You are also with us as we pursue freedom for the oppressed, provision for the naked and hungry, mercy for those who merit wrath, forgiveness for those who have wronged us, grace and good news to those who long for a different way, and abounding love for our neighbors, both locally and globally. You are King, the Alpha and Omega are always present, nearer than we could ever imagine. You are a brilliant light that shines into the darkness. You, Jesus, are the one who changes everything. Thank you for meeting us in the richness of your love. Thank you for providing us with a supportive and loving community. Thank you for proving yourself to be true and faithful time and time again. You are generous in all your ways. As you have met us with your presence, we pray that the world around us will be met with your presence, and that your wholeness and peace will reign, that division will be replaced with reconciliation, and that sin and darkness flee as love bubbles forth in the hearts and minds of humanity. Give us the strength to join with you in this space and all the spaces you inhabit. We take hold of your invitation to love with purpose and intention. Show us what that looks like today. Now, would you join me in praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Created all these things, recall. Good morning. Today I will be doing a reading from Romans chapter 15, verses 5 through 6. It's very short, very sweet. You can find it in the, hold on, I brought this paper and I didn't bring this with me. The scripture reading is on page 1765, or of course on the side televisions. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ had, so that with one mind and with one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
So we are continuing our series on blessing, words spoken through and to the people of God. This one is from the book of Romans, and it has three parts that I want to kind of go through. So part one are the gifts, endurance, encouragement. Just want to throw that out there. If encouragement and endurance are gifts you wish to receive, that you need, got good news about this sermon. If you don't need those things, then you have good news for me, because I would love to learn from you. So these gifts lead, enable, empower the second part of this blessing, which is the mind of Christ. And that leads to the purpose, what it is all for, glorifying God the Father with one mind and one voice. The gift that comes to us from God of endurance and encouragement, leading to a body of God's people who with one voice and one mind have the mind of Christ to bring glory to God. So I want to go backwards through this text. I want to start with, what does it mean for us to bring God glory? Why is that so important? And as is frequently asked by, we'll say, critics of our faith, does God need our glory? Is he coming? Why does God ask for our praise and worship? Is it something in him, or is it something for us? Why? We were in a Bible study this Tuesday, men's Bible study, 6:30 a.m. on Zoom. People ask me all the time, do we have any Bible studies? And then I say it's 6:30 on Zoom, and they go, oh. And I don't know which one is the bigger deterrent. But it was a great conversation. And in that conversation, Paul talked about being jealous. And so we were talking about the history, the tradition in Scripture, where God describes himself as a jealous God. Now, have you ever thought about that? Does that feel odd that God is jealous? Is God jealous of other gods? Does he say, oh, I want what you're giving Marduk? You know, why can't I have what you're giving Baal? Or is that God jealous of? And as we discuss that, the gods we create, they're fundamentally like us. So we are insecure. So of course the gods we create are insecure. We're angry, we're vindictive, we want our will imposed on the world. So of course, when we think about God, our temptation is to take our own insecurities and challenges and problems and project them onto God. But there's a little preposition to the word jealous that is important. God isn't jealous of, he's jealous for. So let me illustrate the difference between these. Let me give you an example. You're going to have to keep track of some names in this example. So let's say Beth was in a relationship with Bill, but now is in a relationship with Bob. And let's say Bob, not a good guy. Poor Beth. So you've got Bill, who knows about this. There's two ways his jealousy can flow. If it's internal, then Bill is jealous of Bob. Bill wants what Bob has. But if he truly cares about Beth and knows that Bob is not good for Beth, then Bill will be jealous for Beth or on behalf of Beth, because he's not thinking of himself, he's thinking of her. And so the question is God's jealousy more like Bob's jealousy of Bill or Bob's jealousy for Beth? That could have been less confusing. I realize that now. And here's, let me just skip forward to that. Sounds like a riddle of some kind. Into what I think is important for us to understand. God is jealous for us. God wants his people to flourish. He's not jealous of the places we put our affection. God has no need of us or for us. But because God loves us, that means God is zealous and jealous for our flourishing and goodness. So tie it to this idea of a people who bring glory to God. It's not that God needs our validation and affirmation. It's not like God is in heaven thinking, I hope they like me. I hope they love me. But instead, fully, in as the three-in-one God, who is the God of Scripture, the God whom we worship, does not need us to bring him glory. Because glory is already his. You know, the Hebrew word for glory is the word that means weight or heavy. And when you think about the way that we use the word weight or weightiness, if there is a moment that feels or is sacred to us, we might say, it was heavy. That was a heavy moment. If it was a time that wasn't so heavy, we might say it was light. And then those light moments, those fun, we need those, but those don't carry the sacred with it. When God speaks, when the Scripture speaks of God as having glory, it's the heaviness, the substance. It's even the way we use the word that mattered. Matter is tied to this idea of weight, of glory, of goodness. These moments, these transcendent moments, these moments of grief, of loss, of connection. There is glory and heaviness and weight to these moments. Scripture says about God, the whole earth is filled with what? His glory, as the waters cover the sea. And of course, the waters are the sea. That glory of God is all around us, connected to our life, connected to what is beautiful and good, connected to the grief and loss we experience, which reveals to us how important and significant and even transcendent some things are. Giving glory to God together as the people of God is recognizing and acknowledging that God's place in our lives, in the universe, his glory all around us. Not because we don't matter, we do. When we acknowledge and confess God's goodness and his glory. Let me give you an example of why this is so significant. I want you to think about in a time when, I mean, I'll just say it, a time when the division is prevalent, in an age of denominationalism where we worship and in different spaces with different traditions and things. I just want to throw out there that unity is difficult. Unity requires something bigger than unity for us to build our lives around. So in Romans 15, Romans 14. As Romans, with 16 chapters, is drawing to a close, Paul's great theological magnum opus, he comes to two groups and classes of people. Two groups. Group one, he calls weak, and group two, he calls strong. I don't want to get too tied up in why he says weak and strong, so let's just put those terms aside and say the issue that Paul's writing to is there is one group of people whom were very scrupulous about following the rules. There's this idea of self-denial. And so he talks about food. And he says one group only has a very restrictive diet. They see honoring God through self-denial, through abstaining from certain foods and drinks, through taking certain days and being very careful about how you honor the Sabbath, how you honor certain high holidays. So the group one are, we'll call them, I don't know, I'm trying to find a word that describes them that doesn't get us down the wrong path. So we'll say, the group one, they're the temperance group, that we need to live a temperate life. The group two, the other group that Paul describes, enjoy a good steak, that they see the gospel, the good news, Peter's vision of opening the door to bacon, to shrimp, that these kosher laws that had defined God's people for so long, that through Christ now there's all kinds of the food and this general idea that you can glorify God through eating a delicious, well-cooked scallop. We'll just to use an analogy here. And you can imagine if two factions within the church that Paul is writing to have two very different ways of seeking to bring God glory. Group one, the temperance group, do it through denial. Would say, I would rather not potentially dishonor God by eating something that he doesn't happy with. I would rather err on the side of safety. And this other group that says, but there's so much good things to eat. I glorify God by enjoying a good meal. I honor God not by thinking about how many steps I'm taking on Sabbath, but opening up the world and enjoying a good walk and not thinking so much about how closely I am to the rules. Now, just caveat, some of this is a little bit like, I don't know if that's what Paul would say. Read Romans 14 and see that see if I'm giving it a fair due, because I don't want to presume anything right now. But you can imagine these two groups, there'd be a lot of tension between these groups. I mean, you lived through the 60s. You know, well, many of you did, lived through the 60s. You know that the freedom group and the temperance group don't naturally get along. And as you read through Paul's articulation of these two groups, the expectation is that Paul will settle it, will say, everybody enjoy something that may betray some of your consciences, or he may say, everybody deny something, knowing that God can be glorified and in activities of just enjoying the good world that God has made. But he doesn't pick a side. If he says anything, those of you whose conscience is a little bit more biased towards freedom, then when you're with somebody that has a little bit more of a struggle there, that conscience is a little bit weaker, that Paul uses, then what you do is you put aside your preferences, enjoying them in glorifying God through being a little bit more restrictive. It's almost like Paul is talking to adults. But you can see in there that while that's not a hard and fast rule, where a lot of communities just tell me what the rules are so I can follow them and obey them until those rules end up making you an outsider, which can happen. What Paul is saying is the point of all this are two groups that are seeking to glorify God with their bodies. And if you have a little bit more freedom in an area, don't use your freedom to make somebody else experience, and the word he uses there is connected to the idea of anxiety. Don't betray somebody's conscience. Don't make somebody have that feeling of doing something wrong. Let me put it a little bit more bluntly, if I may. Nobody gains spiritual maturity by mocking the immaturity of somebody else. Nobody impresses God by shaming somebody else's conscience and what they will or will not eat. And Nobody is attracted to a church where we all look and act and eat the same things. What we need are people that can be held together by something bigger than these minor issues. And you know what that thing is? Bringing glory to God through our choices. Paul says, look at the idea. One person seeks to bring glory to God through their abstinence. Another through their, I was going to say indulgence, but again, enjoyment, we'll say. I'm trying not to bias the language here. He says, can't you see that all are bringing glory to God? And just as a tiebreaker, err on the side of being more strict. Just for the weak, strong thing. You can read that on your own. But let me just suggest that this kind of unity doesn't come naturally to you or to me, to us. This unity where we give each other the benefit of the doubt, where we say, I believe you when you say you're seeking to bring glory to God. I trust you and I will follow your lead, does not come naturally to us. So what's the middle part? The mind of Christ. Now, I want to just draw attention to the fact that Paul doesn't say the heart of Christ here. He says the mind of Christ. What kinds of things Jesus thinks about, how he processes the world around him, what he thinks about with people. I've been really struck in studying this passage to think, what did Jesus think about in idle moments? What was on his mind? I began thinking of some just random Bible passages. I thought about Matthew. You know what Matthew was before he became a disciple? He was a tax collector. I know some of you are muttering it. That's how tax collectors would have been talked about. Here's somebody that was Jewish by birth, Jewish by heritage, but had forsaken his birthright to get paid by Rome to tax his own people. So this isn't just like the IRS, somebody's got to do the job. You know, I was in DC walking and I saw the IRS building, and let me tell you, the exit for employees is obscure. It's hard to find because it's not like people proudly walk out of the IRS, you know. But, sorry, I didn't mean to bring up the IRS, but whatever feelings you have about the IRS, multiply that by 10, because it's not just the fact that they are collecting money on behalf of the state. It's betrayal of who they are. It's saying, I understand the economy of this place. I'm from here. I can use that knowledge to profit Rome. The worst people. So when Jesus calls Matthew, it's not like people are like, oh, that's an odd choice. They're like, I don't want to follow a rabbi that has Matthew as a disciple. I would never. He is irredeemable. He is not a son of Abraham. He's not one of us. He has no business following Jesus. But what was on Jesus' mind? Do you think he was like, this is going to be controversial? This is going to rile them up a little bit. This is going to thin the herd. Or is he just looking at Matthew, his potential? Maybe he sees as Jesus walks by something he missed along the way, this longing to be part of this revolution of Jesus coming, this longing for a rabbi to look at him and say, you would make a great disciple. Because what did Matthew do? He jumped out of that tax booth. He walked straight up to Jesus. What was on Jesus's mind? What was on Jesus's mind when a woman with a bad reputation interrupted a dinner party with a Pharisee named Simon and began to wash his feet? What is he thinking in there? Well, we know a little bit from that passage because Jesus tells us, Simon, do you see this woman? Let me tell you what I see. Let me tell you what I'm thinking about. I see someone who is seeking to honor me. I see an act of gratitude, of generosity, of humility. What was he thinking about when the sick were brought to him? When a sick man, a paralytic, was lowered through the roof in the middle of his sermon, of his teaching, did he think, I was just getting to the denouement of my sermon. Or did he forget all of that and just see a person in need with some friends looking down, hoping that Jesus would heal their friend? When you think about what's on Jesus' mind, what are some of the words that come to your mind? Generous, kind, merciful. I think able to cut through what I'm trying to present myself as to the heart behind it, for better, for worse. His mind as he's walking, and they did a lot of walking back then. Whenever Jesus moves from one city to another, 1 to 3 days of walking. What happens when you're walking with friends? Where does Jesus's mind go? What do they talk about on these many trips, these many walks? What is Jesus envisioning of what God is doing all around him? What's his vision as his mind drifts towards peace, unity, as his heart grieves as Jesus did over Jerusalem for the path that they had chosen in that moment? What occupies his imagination? Does Jesus daydream? What sorts of things in Jesus' idle mind, where does it drift? And as I thought about this, I thought, I want a mind like that. I want a mind that is able to focus on the kinds of things Jesus' mind focused on. I want to see the world as he saw the world. And the good news in this blessing is Paul says, God is happy to give that mind to us, to unify that mind, our community, to unify the people of God through the mind of Christ, the logic, the thinking, the dreams, how Jesus made decisions, how he knew when it was time to withdraw, to pray. I hope and pray that all of us want that kind of mind. Let me read 2 verses. It's Romans 15, 1 through 2. I forgot to give it in the back so you can read along or just listen to me. But here's what Paul is saying right before he gives this blessing. So he's talking about the strong and weak. He's talking about something that is fracturing and splitting the church whom he's writing to. And then he says in verse 1 of chapter 15, we who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. Here's some hints about what Paul is thinking about when he's talking about the mind of Christ. The strong bearing the weak. Failure means there's an element of forgiveness and mercy. Setting aside your needs, your ambitions, and thinking about the person next to you, your neighbor. This is what glorifying God looks like, bearing with each other, giving one another the benefit of the doubt. There's one gift I want. It's to give people the benefit of the doubt, to trust one another. The mind of Christ leading to glorifying God, Paul gives us 2 tools, 2 resources to help us on that journey. And I asked you, how many of you want encouragement and endurance? And I'll ask again, is that something that you want? As we go through this glorifying God, one mind, together, putting aside differences, what we will need is endurance and encouragement. So, the assumption of this text, the assumption of saying, I'm going to give you endurance and encouragement, means the temptations along the way are going to be quitting, becoming discouraged, burning out. If the tools given to you tell you something about the job you're going to have. And if I were to say to you, I have a word of God from you, in this season, you're going to need encouragement and endurance. You would say, oh, I was hoping for the gift of being able to steward vast resources. The fact that you're telling me I need encouragement and endurance means there's a long and difficult road ahead. So the first thing to notice on the gifts is, of course, deep community is hard. Of course it is. We would have no letters from Paul if it were easy, because he wouldn't have needed to write a letter. They'd have already gotten it. You know, it's one of the jokes about the early church is you say, I want to go back to the early church. You say, yeah, which one are you thinking of? You know, because they looked much like our churches look. When do you need endurance? When you're tempted to quit. When it gets too much and you just want to stop. When things are getting hard. When do you need encouragement? Well, when you're pulled towards despair, giving up, when you start to wonder, what's this all for? Encouragement usually comes in the form of a reminder of two things. One, it's worth it. And two, you're doing a good job. Keep going. It's amazing how much an encouraging word helps. And being, let me remind you, this is written to a community of God's people, which means our joyful opportunity, which is why we're talking about blessing over these next few weeks, is to bless one another with encouragement. It's hard. Without endurance, we would just quit. Without encouragement, we would just burn out. Unity is difficult. Paul knows this, which is why he blesses us with endurance and encouragement in the mind of Christ, that we might bring glory to God. So would you stand so I can bless you? May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give to you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Christ Jesus himself had, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's remain standing and sing together hymn number 283, We Are God's People. I know I already blessed you, but who has too many blessings? I don't know. We receive now your blessing from 1 John chapter 4. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. So friends, since God has so loved us, may we also love one another. For no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Amen.